How's everyone doing today? You guys good? Good. I'm gonna try to keep this high energy, informational, and I'm gonna try to entertain you as much as possible. And hopefully the idea behind today is motivating everybody to go out and see the streets the way I see them, see the streets that you should be seeing them, and really take full advantage of everything that we have out there. I'm guessing most people live in New York or from New York, live around New York. Okay. We have the advantage of having one of the greatest cities in the world at our fingertips. So that's my goal today, is to get you guys to look at New York in a whole different way. A little bit about me before we start. I've been shooting street photography probably about 4 or 5 years. I've been shooting in general about 7, 8 years. My roots were in fashion, portraiture. Who I first started studying under was a fashion editorial photographer. So a lot of what I took from that was learning to see the light and the way that light reflects off people, the way that, you know, people are captured in that essence. And so I've always had a love for the streets. So a couple years ago, I started going out, taking my camera with me everywhere I went. And one thing kind of blended into another. I started to look at the fashion in the streets. I started to look at New York streets in a whole different light. So it kind of turned me from a wannabe fashion editorial portrait photographer into primarily a street and portrait photographer, and street portraiture is a lot of what I do. As you'll see with my work today, it's very people-centric. I love people. I studied psychology and sociology in college, and it just really gave me a love for analyzing people, people watching, you know, what makes people tick, why they do what they do. So just to lay out a little bit for you how we're gonna do it today, is I'm gonna go over some of the basics. I'm gonna take you through my process before hitting the streets, my approach to street photography. I'm gonna walk you through some of the settings that I use, and I try, you know, I don't wanna make it too technical, but I do wanna go over a couple things that I feel make it easier to capture images in the street. And then we're gonna go into some images, and we're gonna talk about my thought process and my creative process when I'm actually out in the streets shooting. And what we'll do is we'll go over some of my pictures. And these are some of my favorite shots. I try to bring an eclectic mix of different, you know, a different variety of photos so that we're not just looking at the same thing over and over. I travel all over New York, every neighborhood, and I like to bring that, you know, into my presentation so that you're not just seeing one thing, to kind of keep it interesting. And like I said, I really want to motivate everybody in here. You know, I want you to leave here having learned something and being motivated to go out into the streets and capture everything you see. So we're gonna go into before we hit the streets. What I currently shoot with, I shoot with a couple Canon full frame cameras. I know now mirrorless cameras are popping up on the scene, and people always ask. So why I go over what I shoot with is because someone ultimately, when I open it up for questions, someone's gonna ask, what do you shoot with? What lens, what camera? It really doesn't matter. I go over this just because people are curious. People want to know, how are you capturing your images? Is my arm often hanging off at the end of the day from carrying around a full-frame camera with the lens, you know, L lens on it? Yes, it's heavy. It's horrible. I hate it, but it's what I'm comfortable doing. I haven't made the jump to mirrorless. I've always shot with DSLRs, so that's what I shoot with. As far as my choice of lenses, you'll see three lenses there. You have a 24-70. 2.8 Canon lens, you have an 85 1.8 portrait lens, and then you'll have my sleeper. It's a 70 to 210 lens that I got for $50 off someone on eBay. I used to shoot with the 70 to 200 2.8, and it's pretty much like carrying around a cement block on your arm all day. I've changed the style. My portraiture and my street photography have evolved, and I found that I'm not shooting from afar as much as I used to. And that's something that comes with the process. As you get more comfortable, it's more about the interaction, and you start to see that. And to keep it completely honest, the only time I really shoot with that lens are the days where I go out and I feel like just putting headphones on and turning off to the world and shooting things from across the street and from a distance. And that's pretty much as honest as it gets. I think that, you know, telephotos, they're are great uses for them. My use for it is just when I want to stay out of people's way and I just kind of want to view the world from afar. The 85 millimeter is for primarily portraits. I don't do too much of my street scenes with that. The bulk of what I shoot is with a 24-70 lens. I like the range. I know people, you know, some people prefer all Zooms, some people prefer all Primes, and I like what a Zoom affords me. You know, I can treat it like a Prime if I need to, and it's very versatile. My settings for success. I set my camera the same way every time I hit the streets. It's all about ease. It's all about quickness. As you all know, New York City does not stop for anyone. As much as I'd love it to sometimes, there's times where I've missed great shots because I ultimately didn't have my camera set a certain way. And I've found that the best way to set my camera is in the way that makes it easiest to get shots quickly. So we'll start with my settings for success. I do shoot in pretty much what's considered an automatic mode. It's not program, it's not the little dial that picks a scene mode for you where you have the little guy swimming when you want to shoot action shots. But for all intents and purposes, aperture priority mode is an automatic mode. We all know about the exposure triangle, I'm assuming, and with aperture priority, I'm choosing my aperture and I'm choosing my ISO and I'm letting the camera do the rest. The reason I do this, it's just easier. When I'm out there in the streets, a lot of, you know, there's a lot of buildings, there's a lot of changing light. You're going into shadows, out of shadows. You're having people moving, I'm moving. What I want to do is I want to just minimize the playing around with the dials. With evaluative metering, again, with everything I tell you today, I'm telling you my way of doing it. I'm not saying it's the best way of doing it. I know a lot of people say this is the only way to do it, you know. I want you to come in here with a clear mind and leave here with a clear mind. I shoot evaluative metering and I stick to evaluative metering just because if I know how my camera is metering, it allows me to make changes on the fly. So I know that when I shoot in evaluative metering, if I come into a tricky light situation, I already know how my camera is going to read it. I know how my camera is going to meter. If I do need to make changes on the fly, we have exposure compensation. Just by a quick show of hands, who uses aperture priority with exposure compensation? Okay, so a fair amount. For those of you who don't, it's something to consider. Like I said, everybody has their own way to do things, and even, you know, if I were to shoot in studio, when I shoot in studio, it's completely separate. But for shooting on the streets, I found that aperture priority mode with the use of exposure compensation works very good for me. I generally set my ISO in a median range. This is always the big, not argument, but the thing that I see the most of a disconnect with is everybody comes in and I've told people, well, bump your ISO up to 1600. And you know, when the light gets down, and they're saying, well, wait, shouldn't I go as low? That's what everyone's taught. High ISO is noise, and street photography to me is grain, it is noise, it's raw, it's gritty. I grew up, you know, idolizing the street photographers who were out in New York in the 1980s and 1970s, and you'd be hard-pressed to find one of those images that isn't raw and gritty. I mean, that's what the streets were. That's what the streets still are today. So when people tell me, oh, well, don't bump your ISO up, I tell them I love it. I love the look. And again, it makes things a little easier when I go out and shoot. I'm not playing with my settings as much. I say a nice median range, and I mean anywhere from 400 to 640 in my ISO range is a lot of times what I go out shooting with. Now, granted, if I'm out in broad daylight, you're gonna have to bring it way down. But what we're trying to do, and what when I go out and shoot, I like to keep at my settings in a range where I don't have to play around with my camera a lot. I wanna spend all my time seeing the streets. I wanna spend time looking for what's coming my way, you know, setting up my shots, and not with my head down fumbling around with my camera. The last thing, setting-wise, that I think is pretty important with the way I shoot is back button focus. Again, show of hands, does anybody use back button focus? Okay, about the same amount. Back button focus, it separates your shutter from the whole autofocus system. And a lot of people that, you know, when it came into to popular use was with sports photographers, where you'd have, you know, your subject locked and you'd have something come into your frame and you wanted to still have that focus. And street photography is action photography in a sense. You have a lot of moving parts. And I've just found that ever since I started shooting back button focus, my success rates for shots has skyrocketed. I'm just able to see better knowing that I'm not going to have somebody come into the frame and throw my focus off. My rules of the street. So we're gonna break these down. Know the hood, respect the hood. to candid or not to candid, and would I avoid sometimes, maybe. Know the hood, respect the hood. Know the neighborhood you're shooting in. Knowledge is definitely power when you go out in the streets, and some of the neighborhoods that I shoot in, if you go in there clueless, you're gonna either come out with a problem or you're gonna come out with nothing to look at the end of the day. And I'm not saying study, you know, and you don't have to pull up a Wikipedia page for each neighborhood, but you wanna know things like the demographics, the history behind the neighborhood, what the crime is like there. And I found that things like that, when I can go into a neighborhood and feel like I belong there, it helps you get better shots. History-wise, when we go out in the streets, you wanna tell a story. And I think that's one of the biggest things that I find in my work is I want people to be transported to that neighborhood. When they look at my work, I want them to feel like they were there and really making an experience. And the way that you do that is by knowing about where you're shooting. If you know the history behind a neighborhood, New York City is constantly changing. And every time I go out, I want to capture that feel of, you know, where was the neighborhood? Where's the neighborhood going? Where is it at right now? You know, we look at our pictures and our pictures are history. You know, I look at old pictures and I look at my work and I'm like, wow, someday I'm going to be looking at my work from now like I look at the photos from the 1980s and the 1970s, I hope. And I hope other people are going to be looking at my work too. But it is important to know what you're getting into. I shoot in a lot of rough areas and it pays to, you know, for me, I'm more of a chameleon when it comes to that, where I can go onto the Upper West Side, the Upper East Side, and I can get along with the locals there, and I can go to the East Side of Harlem. I can go out into East New York, Brooklyn, and get along with the locals there. It's more about being genuine, knowing, you know, knowing where to go, where not to go, knowing how the people are going to see you, knowing how you think they're going, you know, they think that you're going to see them. And I think the more information you have going in, it allows for better shots. To candid or not to candid. This is always a huge sticking point. I teach a fair amount of street photography workshops on location, and this is always one of the biggest things that I get asked, and it's kind of a recurring theme is, well, when do you, you know, ask somebody permission? When do you, you know, take candid shots? How do you differentiate between the two? What happens when you get caught? So being genuine is probably your biggest friend. From teaching I've taught levels from hobbyists to amateurs to semi-pros to even some professionals. And I would say 9 out of 10 people think they're slicker than they are when they're out in the streets. I'm constantly observing my students and observing other photographers. And I've been out in the streets myself and I see someone taking a picture of me and always like wave, like I saw you, like I know what you're doing. When I do take candid shots, there's a couple of rules that I live by. Number one, no eye contact. If I'm taking a picture, if I'm taking a picture of you, sir, and you're doing something that has caught my eye, I snap a shot, I immediately get up and I look around. I never make eye contact. Once you make eye contact, you might as well hold up a sign that says, hey, sir, I just took a picture of you. You never know what you're getting on the streets. New York is New York. Second, know your settings, take test shots, and practice will always make you quicker. By this, I mean, if you're sitting at a location, and street photography is a lot of sitting, a lot of patience, I'll sit there and I'll just fire test shots. These are just what I call like burner shots. I'm just, you know, I'm not trying to use them. What I'm doing is I'm getting a gauge for my lighting. I'm getting a gauge for my settings. If I want to capture somebody and I want to capture a motion blur, I'm taking test shots to say, you know what, when that right person comes by, if I want to create a nice little motion drag, what is the optimum setting that I want to be at? Is my light coming in really hot? Do I want to underexpose? So that way, you know, when I do have that nice backdrop and I have that nice, you know, perfect character walk by, I want to be able to capture it. And like I said, street photography, it's all about speed. You know, nobody's going to wait for you. Nobody's going to be walking down the street and stop and say, oh, did you get that? Hold on, let me go back. Like, never happens. Not at least when you're taking candid shots. And here we go back to the telephoto. If you're not comfortable, the telephoto can be your friend. For people who are starting out, for me, I use the telephoto when I want. You know, I'm comfortable enough where I can go out and I can interact. And like I said before, some days I just don't want to. I just want to put my headphones on. I want to drown out. And it's probably not the best way to approach the streets, but everybody has their days. But for any of you who are beginners and you want to go out and you don't have that comfortability factor, use the telephoto. What that does is it slowly breaks you in to seeing things on the street. You know, capture things from afar. When you use a telephoto, you're obviously looking different. You're looking a block ahead instead of right in front of you. You know, so it changes the whole way you approach the streets. And while it's doing, you know, while you're doing that, you're breaking yourself down. You're breaking down your barriers. You're getting more comfortable in the streets. You're getting more comfortable carrying a camera in the streets, looking at people in the streets, and having people see you. You know, street photography is, you know, when you hit the most effective point is when you're completely blending into the streets to the point where people aren't even noticing you. When you get caught, there's a couple different levels of this. I'm 6'2", about 200 pounds. So when I get caught, I usually don't have an issue. Usually they just look at me. And then I keep, you know, I like the reaction shot. It all depends where you're at. I know enough to not go into certain neighborhoods and try to sneak a candid because, for one, every time I go somewhere, if I go into the east side of Harlem all the time, and I'm a cop there. So the minute I'm walking down the streets with a camera, I'm a cop, and I know that everyone looks at me like, all right, he doesn't belong here, he's a cop. You know, and I'm walking in the projects, and I was in there one time, and I had a big 70 to 200 telephoto lens, and I had a guy walk by me, and he's like, hey, officer, don't take too many pictures down here. And I just kind of smiled at him, and I'm like, oh, man, like, all right, covers up. Whatever, you know, perception is stronger than reality. If they think I'm a cop, I'm a cop, and they're not going to open up. Now, like I said, I don't generally get too many problems when people catch me taking pictures of them. Normally, it's just a glare, which I like getting that look. But if you get caught, it's like I said, take a picture of somebody you got caught, look up, look past them. I always look down like this and play with my settings, and I'm like, and 9 times out of 10, what do? And by the time they turn back around, I'm gone. I don't hang around. Especially some of the people that I'm taking pictures of, it's kind of like, boom, and I'm running. I'm not trying to wait around to see if they're mad or not. But it's useful. You know, if you sit there and you take a picture of someone and you stare right at them, and they're looking at you, and it's like, all right, confrontation, there you go. I don't like confrontation. I like to be, you know, seen, not heard, and dealt with. Second point of that, is the shot worth the trouble? Is it really? I mean, how many shots are you going to take? Is this going to be the shot that's going to get you on the cover of some magazine? Probably not. I've taken thousands of shots, and how many of them are on a cover of a magazine? Yeah, none. So most of the time, it's not worth the trouble. It's just a picture. I tell people this when I teach them. And luckily, I've only had to de-escalate one situation in any of my workshops. And it just came down to people not respecting the neighborhood. You know, you're not respecting that you're going into somebody's home. And to, you know, it's like a zoo mentality. You don't want to have that zoo mentality. Because someone is going to ask, someone's still going to ask, by the way, after I go over this, when the question and answer session comes around, someone will probably ask some variation of this question. It revolves the legality of street photography. I can sit here and bore you and go into all the legal mumbo jumbo and all that. And basically what it comes down to is if you're in public and you're taking a picture of somebody, sure, they can get super mad. They can get up in your face and they can create a scene, but is it illegal? No. Unless you're using it, you know, without their permission for commercial purposes, they really don't have a leg to stand on. And even beyond that, if you're respectful, then you're not gonna run into these situations. You know, there's a couple recurring themes that you're gonna hear me keep talking about, and one of them is respect. It's having respect for the neighborhood you're in, having respect for the city you're in, having respect for the people that you're taking pictures of. I've run into many situations, and we're gonna go into one of them later on when I go over some of my shots. And it was, you know, situation where I took a candid of someone, and I ran into her a couple weeks later, and I went up and I initiated a conversation with her. And it was really funny because she says, you know, I asked her if I could take a picture, and she says, well, how about this? She was a dog walker, she had like 6 dogs, and she said, how about I have you hold the dogs, and I have your friend there take a picture of you? I was like, all right, let's do it. She's like, you know, I always hate when people, it's like I'm a seen, you know, when I walk down the street and I'm sitting there thinking like, all right, like 2 weeks ago, I took a picture of you without asking. And she doesn't know this. And unless she's in the crowd today, which I don't see her, I don't see any dogs here, she's probably never gonna know. But it was interesting to me, and you know, I'm constantly learning from my experiences in the streets. What, you know, some people, if you just go up to them and initiate conversation, I think, you know, people have these walls up and they you know, they don't want to interact with people and they don't want to give people a chance to say, yeah, you can take my picture. But again, we'll go into, and as I, you know, go through some pictures, we'll go into when do I candid, when do I not candid? You know, when is the right time to grab a shot? When is the right time to, you know, stop the person, initiate conversation, and then ask for the picture? This right here is a candid shot from the One Train. And I shot this one from the hip. I find myself from time to time, if I'm in tight quarters or, you know, there's no better way to take a candid shot than to just shoot it from your hip like that. And I kind of lucked out on this one. I was riding the train with my wife. I looked over and I saw four different women holding the same subway pole. There were four different nationalities, all the same gender, four different age groups. It was immediately a powerful shot to me. I mean, that's what New York is. New York is a melting pot. And I couldn't obviously walk up to them and say, hey, can you ladies just hold your hands there? And, you know, there's certain opportunities like this where you just have to grab it and you have to be quick. You know, how many times have I wanted to take a picture on the subway? And I'm sure anybody who's brought their camera on the subway, you know, can sympathize with this one. You say, all right, once the train stops and I have a nice still train, I'm going to take a picture of it. And before you know it, someone buds in, someone gets in front of you, your circumstances change. Speed. Another theme that we're going to keep coming back to. Just do it. Don't think about it. Just grab the shot. It's another candid. And if you look at the guy on the left and actually the guy on the right, neither of them is fooled. I made no bones about the fact that I wanted the picture. I have almost an obsession with timeless photography. Like I said, I love old New York photos. I love old New York subway photos. I looked at this photo and I'm like, wow, you can't even tell what era this is. This could be from the 80s, this could be from the 70s, this could be from the 90s. And lo and behold, it's from 2050. So one of the things I liked about this shot, not just, you know, the element of the guy looking at me from inside the subway car, the guy looking, you know, kind of past me on the left, but you have the reflections on the train. Things like this that, you know, I saw on the fly, I had my camera set perfectly and was able to capture.
What was your setting?
My settings on this, in the subways I shoot anywhere from ISO 2000, you know, in the 2000s range up to 6400. I always shoot as wide open as possible. So this would have been shot at f2.8. Here's another candid shot from the subway. This was over in Brooklyn. And pretty much, you know, I'm not gonna go up and bang on the glass and say, hey, hold on, can you guys just wait there, right like that? A situation like this, you have to grab the shot. You can't wait. You know that train's gonna pull out any second. There's not even a thought process. You really just have to get your camera up, get the shot before something changes and before they notice you, because I can probably show you about 3,000 shots that I have where people are sitting in a subway car like this towards the window and they don't want to pose for me. There's our dog walker. I really shot this candid. I got caught off guard. I was across the street. I really didn't have the opportunity to go and stop her. And to be completely honest, I probably would, you know, even if I had the opportunity, I wasn't going to chase her across traffic. And, you know, I liked the composition of it from across the street. I liked the look on her face. So I love the candid shot, you know, and now after having that experience with her, I wouldn't have got the shot if I went up to her. She was very shy. She didn't want to have her picture taken. You know what? Sometimes you just got to grab, you know, take what you can get. Another instance, this was over in Harlem. And this, I actually shot this fairly recently. It was one of the days where it was a torrential downpour. And I saw them coming from across the street and I waited and I played with my settings or acted like I was playing with my settings and waited for them to pass. And it's one of those things where you just have to grab the moment, just because people change when you stop them. And that's a big driving factor in a lot of my candid photography is I've stopped enough people to know that when you stop people, their whole, you know, their whole operation changes. They're now worried about the camera. They're now only seeing a guy with a camera. You just let people walk by you and grab a shot of them once they pass, and you don't have to worry about that. It's now, you know, you have the home court advantage. It's, you're playing on your terms. This guy right here is actually a candid that turned into a staged portrait and nearly a fight. Not on my end. I was teaching a workshop down in Chinatown, and I saw this guy here, and he was, you know, yelling at people as they walked by, drinking a Corona. And I walked up, and there was really, you know, you see that he's in like a tunnel, like an overpass, under an overpass. So I couldn't use my look away trick, because even this guy, as drunk as he was, he was, you know, wasn't going to fall for the what's he shooting behind me, because the only thing behind him is a wall. So I kind of just had to walk up there with the confidence, like, look, I'm going to take a picture of you, and there's not a thing you can do about it, which is what I did. And he saw it, and this is one of the beautiful things about, you know, interacting with people on the street and being open to interaction, was as soon as I took it, he took a swig of his Corona, and he's like, how do I look? So I went over, I showed him the picture, and he's like, take another one. So then he started posing, and we got into this whole, like, America's Next Top Model on this bench with this guy with this Corona. And, you know, this is actually my favorite shot, because, like I said, once somebody knows that you're taking a picture of them, everything changes. They're no longer, it's no longer that candid moment. Now he thinks he's like Tyra Banks, and, you know, it doesn't work for me. There's certain times where I don't mind a staged portrait, and there's times where I just like the raw, candid nature of a photo. You know, you can see it kind of in his eyes. He's looking at me like, I know you're taking a picture of me, and I'm just going to sit here and let you do your thing. So I took a couple pictures of him. He wanted to see each and every one. You know, it's almost like when you shoot that friend when you start taking pictures, and you go do a photo shoot with someone, and after every picture they're like, let me see, and you can't get into a groove, and I take, here, let me see, and they run over. So he kept on coming over, and he's like, you know, and I'm showing him. So he comes over to me, and he puts his arm on me, and he's like patting like this, and he's like, grabs my arm, and he's like, you're in good shape, let's fight. I was like, so. It's experiences like that that I'm never gonna forget that. Whenever I look at this picture, it's like I'm always gonna remember the entire experience. You know, I don't even need to write this down. It's like I've captured something, and, you know, people say that, oh, your picture should say something. And I don't necessarily agree with that, because if you looked at this picture, you're gonna say, all right, it's a guy who's hot, probably a summer day, he's drinking a Corona on a bench. It's not gonna tell you the full story. You know, I think pictures do need some backstory to them. What I avoid sometimes, maybe, and street photography is like any other genre in photography. There's nothing that's ever certain. Nothing is ever, you know, 100% of the time. There's no like set in stone rules. But there are things that I use guidelines. And one of my guidelines is New York City is not a safari. Don't treat it like one. I was out shooting in Harlem one time, and I ended up talking to this guy. He had a real interesting look. I loved the way he was dressed. I loved his hair. And I stopped him. I was like, you know, you have a real interesting look. He's like, thank you. Now, a lot of times when I go out, even if I don't intend to shoot somebody, I always find myself talking to people, complimenting people as they walk by. And what it does is, I mean, I'm sure you guys have all heard that, you know, if you're in a bad mood, smile, and it makes you in a good mood. Well, when I'm out in the streets, a lot of times I could walk by and I could be like, hey, man, I love your shoes. And he's like, oh, thanks, man. And it just gets me in the mode of talking. Even if I don't intend to stop and take a picture of him, it gets me broken out of my telephoto mode where I'm just gonna sit there and be mute to the world. So I hadn't intended to shoot the guy. I really just wanted some conversation. I was like just sitting there, I was taking a break. And it sparked a conversation where he started telling me about different landmarks right where we were by on 125th Street in Harlem. And he said something to me that stuck with me. And I eventually ended up taking a picture of the guy. And one of the things that stuck with me is he said, you know what, man? He's like, I really appreciate the fact that you had an actual conversation, that you engaged me, and you didn't just come up and either take a picture of me or come up and just ask to take a picture of me right away. He's like, you know, you kind of, you listened to what I had to say, you got to know me. And he said, a lot of times I see people come into the neighborhood and it's like it's the zoo and people are just here to take pictures of the animals. And it was such a powerful thing that he said. And I'm like, you know what? It's right. You know, it's not like you're out in Times Square. It's like you're going into somebody's neighborhood and, you know, Times Square, of course, it's just buildings and you're taking pictures of structures and, hey, I'm in New York City, the crossroads of the world. When you go into some of these neighborhoods, you're in that neighborhood, you know, that place where people go home, where they go out to the grocery store, where they hang out on the block or on their stoop. And it really put things in perspective to me that I'm like, wow, it's like, that's how somebody who lives there sees people coming in with cameras. You know, and it's like, as I'm saying this, these double-decker tour buses are going by, and I'm like, wow, it's like, that's what he's talking about. You know, you just see people aiming, you know, cameras from a tour bus, and it's like, that's totally not what I'm about, and it's not what it should be about. You know, street photography should be an intimate thing. It should be where you're documenting the neighborhoods. You're documenting the people. You're not just doing a drive-by where you're just like, oh, hey, here's Harlem. So that's something that's always stuck with me. No call waiting. If they're on the phone, leave it alone. There's been so many people I've walked by. Everybody's on their phones now. Everybody has headphones in. I can't tell you how many times I've stopped somebody. And, you know, I say, you know, take a portrait of them. And I say, you know, can you just take out the iPhone earbuds? You know, nothing kills a nice street portrait like iPhone earbuds. But if they're just listening to music, you know, again, nothing is ever 100%. It all depends. If they're in the zone or I can tell they're talking on the phone, I won't stop them. If they have a phone up to their ear, again, respect. Rule number one, have respect for people. I know if I were on the phone, I don't know if it's somebody's boss or I don't know if they have a sick mother and they're talking to a family member. Picture's not that important. You know, ultimately, you have to put the respect for the people first. The last two, the homeless and children. These are two hot topics when it comes to street photography. I'm gonna go through some pictures and take you through my thought process, how I do it, when I do it, why I do it, why I don't do it. They're the same in the sense that they're both very sensitive topics, the homeless and then children, but for different reasons. With homeless people, it's very obvious why. You know, you don't wanna exploit people. And again, I know I keep harping on it, but respect. Have respect for the people in the streets. The homeless are people too. Does that mean I never take pictures of them? No. I take pictures of a lot of homeless people, actually. Whether it's me interacting with them, whether it's walking by and just more in a documentary fashion where I'm documenting, you know, these are our times. These are the times we live in, you know? Some people might be looking at my pictures years from now and saying, well, what was it like back then? You know, how was New York City in the 2000s? And I think that photography has that power to take a moment and make it history. Now, children, it's something that's a little more sensitive, especially in this day and age. People don't want, and if I had children, I probably wouldn't want some stranger walking up and snapping off a whole reel of pictures of my kid just for no apparent reason. I mean, these are the worries that people have. And when I say, you know, to know who you're shooting, know where you're shooting, that's one of the things that I'm talking about. You have to understand what people see and what people are going to be thinking and how they're going to perceive you taking pictures. This shot here, I called him the wizard. That's the Flatiron building in the back. So I shot this over in the Flatiron district. And I talked to this guy for a couple minutes and he had like just his whole garb. He had this whole big cart and I genuinely thought it was, you know, I loved his look. You know, he had like this, it almost looked like a big wizard hat. So I went up to him, stopped him, talked to him for a second, and he was pretty incoherent. And to be honest, I kind of struggled on this one because, again, how it would be perceived. And, you know, perception is, I believe, stronger than reality. And I struggled because I really thought it would be a dynamic portrait and I really wanted to capture, you know, this character. But again, I was worried, you know, how are people going to look at it? How are people going to take it? Ultimately, I did talk to him enough. I felt comfortable enough, and I asked him for a picture, and he completely obliged. This shot here, I actually shot last week. I was out shooting with some friends, and I ran between two street meat carts to get this shot. Shot it candidly, and this is something that I see as, it's a powerful image to me. where, you know, I wanted to capture it. For those who want to know, I did shoot it with my $50 telephoto lens. And the reason I did do that is when I was composing the picture in my head, you know, if you shoot it from a wide angle, it kind of spaces everything out. And as you know, the technical aspect behind a telephoto lens, it compresses everything. I wanted to bring all that action that was happening around him and really compress the photo so that you really, it really hit strong that here you have this guy begging for money and his feet are up in the air and he's uncomfortable in his poverty. And you have all these people just walking by. You had tourists and people on their way to work and really not giving a care about that. Now, I don't want to get into personal views on anything. It's, you know, treat all people like humans. And I think that, you know, this says something about how many, you know, how many times do you walk by someone? You don't even really give them a second look. And that's what I wanted to capture in this picture. Again, kind of the same thing, just without the people there. This, I just loved the shot when I walked by. As I'm walking by and I see it, and it's, he was just kind of isolated on the sidewalk. The cup out in front of him with some money in there. You know, just the hands clasped, the head down. In this, you know, I wasn't worried. There was nobody's face being shown. It was more a powerful image of, you know, just a representation of what it's like to be homeless in New York. Right here, another powerful image to me. You know, I think whenever you introduce people into a shot and there's a contrast here. There's, you have people walking by, they're not even giving this guy a second look. He's got, you know, suitcases sprawled out. He's, you know, knotted out on the stoop. And, you know, instantly when this image popped up on the screen, you know, I heard an audible, you know, in the audience here. And that tells you that this image, it hits home in a sense. I don't think these images are exploiting the homeless. You know, I think anybody would be hard pressed to convince me, you know, otherwise that they are an exploitation of the homeless, but more capturing, you know, these are the streets that we are living in. This is what we walk by every day and kind of calling attention to it. Not for good or for bad, but just to put it in your heads that, you know, this is what it's like to be homeless in New York in this day and age. Moving to children now. This is one of my favorite photos I've ever taken. So I was out in the streets and I turn and I see this kid, and immediately, obviously, I see the please no photos, and I'm a photographer and I have a camera in my hand, and I'm like, all right, I'm not gonna let this pass up. He was with his father, and when shooting kids, you know, when you're taking photos of children, you obviously have to be mindful of everything I stated earlier. He was with his father, so I walked up to him, and it's always a very genuine interaction. I don't like to make anything clinical. You know, I'm not gonna stop him and say, excuse me, I'm a photographer, blah, 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 give him all my credentials. You know, so I was like, hey man, I love your shirt. And he kind of smiled and laughed, and his father laughed, and I was like, you know, so I kind of stopped him. I was like, I'm a photographer. I was like, so I have to ask, you know, do I get, you know, a special pass? Do I get to take a picture of you? And he's just kind of like, yeah. So I had his father step aside, and you know, that face that's captured, it was just kind of like how the whole experience was. He was just kind of like, all right, cool, whatever, man. And it's stuck. You know, again, you see that timeless nature where you look at this photo and it could be, you know, any time over the last 30 years. Now, this is a different case. This girl was out with her parents, and she was being cute like most kids are, and she was playing with an umbrella, and her parents were taking pictures of her. And I walked up, and I'm that guy that when I see people out in the streets taking couples pictures or with the forbidden selfie stick, I always go up and I offer to take them a picture. And you know, to be honest, I get offended when people turn me down. It's like, you're taking pictures with a selfie stick? And I was like, fine, like, I have a nice camera. You don't want me to take a picture of you? So, you know. So I went up to him and I was like, hey, I was like, if you want, I'll grab a couple shots of her. I'll give you my card. You guys shoot me an email. I'll send them to you. And of course, they were like, oh, yeah, putting the phone away. And then they're taking pictures. You know, the father's taking pictures of me, taking pictures of her. And so I grabbed a couple shots of her, and it was just super cute, you know. And what actually drove this was my wife is, you know, very much into fashion. And I was like, my wife is gonna love this. My wife is gonna love this little girl. You know, my wife's always like, oh, she's, you know, she's gonna be one of those people that when, you know, when we have kids and grandkids, she's gonna be the cheek puller, like, oh my God, you're so cute. Which is exactly what she did when she saw this picture here. But I stood there for a good 10 minutes just taking photos of her. But, you know, I approached it in a way where it wasn't creepy, it wasn't awkward. It was just a, hey, I'm doing you guys a favor. And they never emailed me for the pictures. So believe it or not, probably 90% of the people that I stop on the street and give them my card and take pictures of them, never even reach out for them. It's interesting, you know, again, being a street photographer, I'm constantly analyzing people and why they do what they do and the way they think. And it's always struck me as odd. It's like we live in a culture where people wake up in the morning, the first thing is like I woke up like this. Like somebody stops you on the street and they want to take a picture of you and it's like, here, I'm not going to charge you. Nope, never hear from them. This was actually shot last week as well. And it was two kids running around a fountain. And this was at Washington Square Park. It was out in the open. Kids were running, splashing. You know, it was one of those situations where everybody's taking pictures. It was just a cute moment. So a moment like this, I think it's any photographer's duty to take a picture of this. If you're a street photographer and you don't capture a moment like this, then, you know, you have a set of standards that I obviously don't know about, because there's nothing I see wrong with this. And I think if there's kids out there being kids, you know, these are the images. You know, you always think of, like, growing up in New York, you think of, like, the images of the kids playing in the fire hydrants. And I think, you know, this is another one. It's like kids splashing around in water being kids. It brings you back to your youth. We're gonna talk about when we hit the streets. We're gonna go over, it's gonna be a lot more pictures and talking about my process, what I was thinking, how I accomplished the shot here. Obviously, the idea is to create interesting photos. We're gonna talk about composition, lighting, and even cropping. I put a question mark behind that because probably any photographer or any photography snob is gonna cropping, like, why does that matter? Cropping is a huge part of my creative process as far as creating interesting images. You know, the end goal is an image that you look at and it sticks in your head, and I believe cropping does play into that. Blur on purpose. This is a little joke on Instagram hashtags and the things people come up with on social media. But the idea is very real. Motion in the streets. New York is constantly in motion. It's, you know, fast moving. Anybody who has traveled to the South or lived in the South or from the South will know that they're, you know, New York, one of the things that sticks out the most is how fast everyone moves, how fast life moves. Juxtaposition. Juxtaposition is huge, and, you know, it's a huge aspect of creating interesting photographs. I am constantly looking for things that juxtapose. You're looking for contrast or, you know, this next to that, and it just creates an interesting photo. Symmetry, geometry, and patterns. That's another thing that always jumps out to me. And it has, you know, to do with the aesthetics, where shapes and patterns are naturally pleasing to the eye. And so it would make sense in your photos that if you see that, capture it. And team color versus team black and white. I'm primarily team black and white. My wife is team color. So I've gotten to the point where I don't even show her my pictures anymore, because I'm just gonna get screamed at if it's in black and white and she doesn't wanna hear it. And what did you do to the beautiful colors? And I'm gonna go over when I look at a photo and I see a color photo and when I look at a photo and I see black and white. And it has to do more with when I shoot the photo than when I'm processing the photo. It's a forethought. So we're gonna go over composition, lighting, and cropping now. Obviously, if you look at, you know, this has a little bit of lighting aspect that makes it interesting as well with the silhouette there. But compositionally, this is what jumps out to you. If I, you know, told you what jumped out first, you know, about this picture, it's probably gonna have something to do with how it's set up, how it's composed. I shot this from probably about 50 yards away on a telephoto lens. And I was out in Flushing Meadows and they have the big globe there, and I saw two skateboarders. No, they're not proposing to one another, which everyone's like, oh, did you catch a proposal? I'm like, no, it's two skateboarders just giving a pound, saying goodbye. But the composition of it, the way that it's, you have the trees that naturally vignette it. Now, I'm very big on doing things in camera and not creating what I call post effects. You know, I think the shot itself should be interesting. You should look for interesting moments and look to create interesting photos and not manufacture them in post-processing. And something that stuck out with this was, you have a clear social exchange with the globe behind it. So it's like, you can kind of start turning the gears and you're like, wow, it says something on a bigger plane. And it really was just two skateboarders saying goodbye. But the fact that they're in front of a globe and it's, you have like a rim lighting. If you see the guy there on the right, it's more prominent, the rim lighting behind him from the street light. And it just really, it was an image that as soon as I saw it from walking up, had to have it. And I wanted to make sure that it was composed properly. You'll see, everybody knows about the rule of thirds with composition. And I think that, again, it's good some of the time, it's not good some of the time. The one thing that I hate and I try to avoid in my pictures, just because it's not aesthetically pleasing and it doesn't grab you, is you have centered and you have the rule of thirds. You have offset. There's a little space in between that I try to stay away from. If something is clearly off-centered, it's gonna draw your eye. It's gonna be more aesthetically pleasing. If something's centered, and if you know certain things that they look better centered, it's gonna suck your eye right into the subject. If something is slightly off-centered, what are you gonna do? In your head, you're gonna say, ah, I just wanna crop this so bad, or I just wanna move that person into the center, or move them over to the right. It's human nature. You want to, you know, your eye wants to put subjects in certain places based on how we see. This right here, clearly off-centered. This was down in Philadelphia, and I ran to catch this shot. We're gonna go over, you know, I'm gonna go over a little later about, you know, foresight and trying to see shots into happening and what I do to achieve them in that circumstance. And I saw this kid walking. He was about 30 feet behind his parents, and him alone, there's nothing interesting about him. It clearly here, what drew me in was that I saw he was walking into a boarded up, gated storefront with a red stripe down it. And I'm like, hit me. And I'm like, wow, this kid's gonna walk right in front of that and I'm gonna have to capture him perfectly. And it worked out for me. But compositionally, you know, I had to get to the spot. I had to, you know, when I talked about setting shots up in advance and kind of seeing things in advance, I got to the spot and was able to capture it exactly how I envisioned it. Lighting. This guy probably would have been a great portrait no matter what light I put him in. He just had, you know, such a strong look, and the beard and the mustache and the aviator glasses was just perfect. So I was out shooting with a friend and we stopped him and we loved his look. We wanted a portrait of him. So I let my friend do her thing. And of course, she puts him in nice even shade and takes an evenly exposed portrait. And it was the way she saw it, and it was a nice portrait. But as she's sitting there taking a picture of him, I'm thinking, how can I, you know, take this up a notch? You know, how can I create an interesting photo? Yes, he has an interesting look, but is the photo interesting? You know, it's kind of like when I see people taking pictures from rooftops. It's like, yeah, it's great. It's an interesting perspective, but is the photo interesting, or is it just interesting because you're on a rooftop? So I tried to take my creative process one step further, and there was an awning. And it was just such a hard line of light across there. And I'm like, you know what? I'm gonna put him in that awning and, you know, cut his face in half. And I literally sat there and plied him, and he was totally cool. He was just waiting for the bus. So I'm like, do you mind if I, like, you know, move you in position? He's like, not at all. And I pulled him and I wanted just that little bit of eye showing. I think it creates kind of an interesting, you know, look to it. And everything is driven by what I see myself, where when I'm looking at someone, there's nothing I hate more than when I'm talking to someone and they have sunglasses on. I can't see their eye. It's like your eye is that thing that connects you. You know, you can look in and kind of, it forms that social bond. So I wanted to show that without really having him take his glasses off. I like the look of the glasses. It adds a bit of mystery. So I'm like, move there. Now I'm back there. Come a little bit, and I'm like, eventually I'm just like, do you mind if I, like, you know? And he's like, all right. So I'm like grabbing his shoulders and I'm like moving him. And I created the shot. I created interest in the shot. You know, we talked about candids, and candid are interesting in their own way, where you kind of just have to take what you can get. But when I have someone that's pliable and that is willing to stop and let me mold them, I try to create, you know, an interesting portrait out of it. Again, with the lighting, I was actually with Alan and Marjorie from B&H when I shot this, and I started jumping up and down. I was like, I just caught that perfect stream of light. It just creates interest where there's no question where your eye goes in this one. So lighting, you know, that stark contrast creates very interesting photos. Cropping. This photo uncropped, it's not as interesting, to put it just bluntly. It's not as interesting of a photo when you look at it and, yeah, it's an interesting shot just because, you know, I sat there and waited to get 5 cabs in a row and was probably there about 20 minutes waiting for the right shot. And, you know, I'm very particular with my photos where, you know, I can sit and wait it out. If I feel that it's going to be a shot that's worth it, I'll wait it out. But I cropped it in such a way as, number one, I want it to fit over my TV. So I saw when I was processing this, I was like, I have to put it on my wall. I fell in love with the shot, and you know, there's just space right above my TV, and it kind of made me think like, yeah, I mean, that is tailor-made to, you know, have that long, the long crop in there. Again, the original shot of this, you have a lot of the roof, you have some lights up there. It kind of distracts you from the madness. I think when you tightly crop this, it really brings the focus into the people, where you're looking now at people's faces. Instead of an entire scene, you're sitting there and you're picking apart and seeing it on a big screen. You know, if you look at it for a minute, you know, this is a morning commute at Grand Central Terminal, and you can kind of just see it's like people are heading to work, and it's like zombies or drones in the morning commute. So it still is an interesting shot either way, but by cropping it to bring the focus more into the people and not on the scene itself, I believe gives it some more interest. Now, this is more of an extreme crop. In the regular, like how I regularly shot this, this is one shot where I did see the crop before I actually took the picture. I saw it was happening. I saw they were going to cross. I sat there and I waited for the right moment. I loved the car there. They get lost in the regular version of this picture, the pre-crop. What's going on there gets lost. And if you look at the elements, just the composition of it, you know, where you, not really the rule of thirds in a sense, but you have things offset where it just is aesthetically pleasing, where one thing kind of leads into the other. You have the graffiti, then it goes to the car, then it goes to the little storefront, then it goes to what's going on over here with the guy walking, and then the food delivery guy, and it ends back with the graffiti in the backdrop. So it kind of ties everything together. And in much the same way, I just felt that the moment, I needed a more concise space to show the moment. I thought this was really interesting. I always love people walking by things and just people being themselves when they don't know they're being observed. And it hits me that, you know, people will walk right by each other. And it's like, you know, it's kind of an interesting thing to me how you'll have this whole wide sidewalk and people walk right by you. You know, it's like when you're in the movie theater and you're the only person in the movie theater and someone sits right next to you and you're kind of just like, why? Like, you know, it's like, I look at stuff like this and, you know, it's shot compressed. It's from a telephoto. So the sidewalk obviously looks a little smaller than it is, but it's a wider sidewalk. And it's like they literally passed right by each other without even a look. And I just think that, you know, number one, the composition of it. Number two, the timing. I'm very particular with, you know, how I time my photos, where I wanted that moment right before they meet. So kind of where it's almost like a puzzle, the way their bodies match in. And just, to me, it creates an interesting look. You guys could be sitting out there saying, I would have erased it on the spot. But to me, it's like, you know, it's about what I see and what I perceive as interesting. Motion in the streets. I'm going to talk about a couple different kinds of motion. We have panning. We have dragging the shutter a little bit. And then even in regards to motion, there's freezing motion. where, you know, action photography, you know, you have two different schools of thought where you can show the blur and kind of get a feel for the motion that's happening, and then you can freeze the motion, and it kind of, in its own way, shows the power of what you're taking the picture of. So this is a panning shot. I worked for this shot. It was about 10 degrees out. I was on the Williamsburg Bridge, and I was out shooting with somebody who takes about 4 hours to take one picture. So I had to find something to do. We were at the point in the Williamsburg Bridge where it connects the pedestrian walkway to the bike walkway, or the bike path. And I had my camera on a tripod. You know, we were messing with some long exposures, and I put my camera on a tripod and I put it on just a straight horizontal swivel. And it was about 2 o'clock in the morning. It's windy, it's cold, the wind is blowing off the water. I'm freezing, I can't even feel my hands, and nobody's coming by. I mean, it's so cold out that we were probably the only morons outside taking pictures. And I see a bike coming. I'm like, I have one shot. Like I'd say, I see it, you know, coming, and he's hauling up the bridge. And I was like, you know, I don't know how I'm gonna do this. So I tell my buddy, and I'm like, run, stand in that spot. So he runs and stands there. I get my, you know, I focus on him, you know, to get my focusing distance on. And I'm like, all right, I got it. I got to nail this. So when I do, the only time I don't shoot in aperture priority is when I'm shooting in shutter priority. So I keep my camera set at an optimal speed for panning. So the only shots that I'm really doing when I'm out in the streets are panning shots. So I've nailed it down. I shoot it about a 20th of a second for New York for like cabs and cars and bikes and people running by. I feel that's a pretty optimal speed for me. Now this was obviously different. It was pitch black and there's like no light. All I had was the light from his bike. So I set it to about 2 seconds and I only had a window. I mean, if you probably right here and then right outside the frame on the other side, it was gates. If you know the Williamsburg Bridge, you know that the Williamsburg Bridge is like being in an enclosure. It's like a fenced in enclosure. So I only had a small window of time to capture that image and pick him up. And if you know anything about panning, you can go out there and sit out there for 20 minutes and it's trial and error. There's really no 100% method to knock down pans every time. It's like, you know, unless you have it calculated out and you know what speed they're going and you do all the math in your head. And I was an English major, so getting into the math and the technical aspect, it's way beyond me. So I caught the light trails, and if you look, there's some blur here. It's not a completely pure shot, but street photography is just that, and photography is just that. It's not always, you know, some people will sit there and they'll pick apart, well, that's blurry and this and that, and it's like, all right, whatever, I don't care. You know, you have to look at the power of the entire image and what was captured here. And I love the light trail that was captured from the lights on his bike. This was a girl swinging. I captured this through a black iron fence. And I, you know, this is one of those images that didn't really jump out to me at first. I think, you know, it's like music. You know, when you hear a song with a good beat, it immediately pulls you in and you don't listen to anything else but the beat. And then some songs, it, you know, initially doesn't do anything for you, and then you listen to it and you listen to it and you like the lyrics. So the song becomes, you know, one of your favorites. And this was kind of the photographic version of that, where it's like I bypassed it in my camera roll a million times and it never really jumped out to me. And then I was like, you know what? That's a pretty damn good shot. I was like, I kind of like it. And it was because I knew what went into it. Now, is there anybody in here that would have, you know, initially looking at it thought, oh yeah, he shot that panning through a black iron fence? Maybe there is, maybe there isn't. But I know what I put into the shot, and it, you know, instead of just taking a picture of a girl on a swing, I tried to make it interesting. I tried to make it, you know, something, I tried to add something to the shot that most people wouldn't walk by and do. And it was very difficult, took a couple tries, but, you know, I'm not completely, you know, thrilled that, you know, she's not all in one piece. There's kind of, but it's the imperfections, I think, that, you know, really jump out there that stick. This was a walking pen. I was down in Chinatown and I was out in the middle of the street as I usually am. And it just kind of hit me. I've never really tried to pan a walking person. So took a shot at it and it's more interesting. You know, this guy, there's really nothing interesting about him. It's not like he has like great style or anything, or he's like has an interesting look. This was more just capturing the motion and capturing a guy walking across the street, and probably, you know, 90% of the people in here are looking like, all right, whatever. But to me, it's like, you know, I'm constantly trying to elevate my photography, trying to take it to the next level. Now, this was shot from a rooftop looking at the Queensboro Bridge, or the 59th Street Bridge, whatever you want to call it now. And to me, you know, it says something. You have the traffic coming into Manhattan, the traffic leaving Manhattan. I always joke with my friends that are from Queens that nobody wants to go to Queens, so it's kind of funny. Like, everyone's trying to get out of there. There's a traffic jam coming into Manhattan, and nobody wants to go to Queens. So, you know, but again, it's, if you look at compositionally, you know, it's compositionally sound, but it's more about the motion there. It's more about capturing, you know, the traffic jam coming in, the flow of cars going out. Motion here at Radio City. Now, I don't do too many night shots. Some people, that's their specialty. For me, it's, you know, kind of if I'm out and I have my camera, but I don't ever really make it a point to go out at night. When I do, I like to capture shots. I like to do what I call semi-long exposure. I bumped my ISO up for this. I didn't want too much drag. When you have too much blur and when the exposure is too long, you lose the motion. So there is that sweet spot where you can kind of still make out what's going on, and it's not just a complete blur, and you know, where you would have the buildings and the cart and the stand there where they would just be the only things there. You want to see some of the motion. I think that's finding that sweet spot where you're not completely losing the madness of the city. This is another way to show motion. This was a composite shot. This is down in the skate park under the Manhattan Bridge. And this guy never emailed me for his picture, so maybe he's watching right now. Maybe he's like out there, like, hey, that's me. It's just the composite of shots. As you see there, there's 9 images, and I just patched the 9 images together. And again, it's always thinking how to create, you know, an interesting shot. How do I, you know, take one shot and I knew in my head, I'm like, I'm gonna do a composite of this. He kept on going and doing whatever he was doing. I don't know the skateboarding term for it, but I wanted to capture that, and I was like, it would be really cool to composite the shots and create an added level versus trying to pan it or trying to just freeze him. And here you have motion frozen. So these are handball courts over on Houston, and it was something where the motion would kind of be all over the place. This is a, you know, I make these decisions, you know, how am I going to capture the motion? And the best case scenario in this was freezing the motion. So I took a bunch of shots. I sat there for probably about 15, 20 minutes waiting for the right composition. I didn't want to have anybody overlapping. I'm very particular again with my composition here, where I waited, I wanted to see each person, and I wanted to see the ball as well. So I sat there, and it's opportunities like these where you have the opportunity to sit there and, you know, kind of wait the shot out. Juxtaposition. So here, this is so Williamsburg to me. Williamsburg is probably one of the most changed neighborhoods that I remember in New York. I remember going out to Williamsburg like 15, 20 years ago, and it was kind of like, where are you? I have my doors locked, like, hurry up. I'd park, I'd go pick my friend up, and we'd be out of there. And now it's like this trendy place, and it blows my mind. And so I find myself always trying to capture that changing. It's completely gentrified now, and it's like, you know, this to me is new Williamsburg. It's like hipsters, you know, you have these fashionable hipsters, and then you have like the punk rocker, or did he just buy that jacket at like American Apparel or something for like $300? It's like, stuff like that is interesting to me, you know, but I look at it and I'm like, it's clearly on the Williamsburg Bridge, and it's captured new Williamsburg coming and going. You know, and shots like that where there's a juxtaposition there that kind of all works together, because, you know, there's the contrast in the two sets of characters, but it's all one Williamsburg. And this one I loved. It's like, I wish that photographers in another lifetime could create like the parking rules and design the cities. You know, I always look and it's like, man, that would be so great if it had like this old vintage car there, an old beater, and it's a Dodge Caravan. It's like, you got it, you know, photographers, we're always saying that. It's like, ah, I would love that shot if there wasn't like a Subaru hatchback and a minivan and, you know, a panel truck there. But the image still jumps out. It's like, you have the guy on the right and he's like, total younger generation. The guy on the left is just looking at him like, what the hell is that guy wearing? And, you know, so you have the juxtaposition. It makes it an interesting shot. Is it an interesting shot? Otherwise, I'll be the first one to tell you no. It's two people walking by on the street in New York. But yeah, just the guy's face and then the face of the young guy is just kind of like, whatever. Symmetry, geometry, and patterns. Here, there's a sense of symmetry here. And also, you know, the thing I loved about this shot was you have just that splash of red on the doors in the middle of the shot. The one door was open, and I just thought it was kind of cool how you have somebody dressed in all red going to fill that space. It was almost like, you know, filling in the gap on the red. But as a whole, the symmetry here works with the architecture. Everyone knows the Whispering Arch and Grand Central Terminal, and here it was about the shapes for me. I love the pattern on the ceiling, the arches. The silhouettes kind of just add to it, but the focus for me here was more about the shapes. And that's what really jumped out, and I wanted to capture what I saw. This, it is a homeless guy, and I kind of love the backstory on this one. What I initially saw was the shapes here. This was right around sunset. And I love the blue hues and the shapes of the shadows. If you look at, you know, the lines here, it's just very geometric to me. I'd set up about probably 35 feet away from him, got down on my knee, and he had his eyes closed. He was just, you know, had his eyes closed. He's just laying there relaxing. Set my shot up, got my focus, and right as I was about to press the shutter, he opened his eyes. And it was just like perfect. Now you can't really see it on the shot, but he had like these like piercing like blue-gray eyes. And it just fit everything. It's like, you know, with the colors and the shapes and the fact that, you know, you see in portraiture, a lot of times what I do is when people have trouble, you know, looking at the camera and giving the right face, what I'll do is I'll tell them to close their eyes. And I'll say on the count of three, open up your eyes. And especially for people who are blinkers, when you open up your eyes, it's just almost like before you can react, there's just that pure moment where you just capture a wonderful portrait. So I couldn't have planned this any better, that he literally opened up his eyes the split second before I pressed the shutter. But it was initially the shapes that drew me into this shot. Again, here's a bit of the same. I love hard shadows. I love, you know, when the shadow cuts across. So you have everything is square, rectangular. You have the line of the power line going across. I'm a junkie for sneakers hanging on, power lines, the street lamps, anything. Anything where sneakers are hanging, I'm a junkie for. But here, what really caught my eye was the hard triangle shape, you know, of that spot of light up in the top, and then the windows and the lines across. Here, this is the 191st Street subway up in Washington Heights, and which is vastly different now. They've painted graffiti down the entire subway tunnel and added more lighting. So this shot, I love it, not only because of, you know, just looking at it for aesthetic reasons, it's kind of like he's just walking into like this like trance. But now the whole dynamic of the tunnel has changed and you used to get those nice arches of light. And this is a luck shot. I wish I could say I sat there for 4 hours and was late for dinner because I was waiting for the right person, but I literally was walking down to shoot the tunnel and, you know, I'm sitting there playing with my camera and I look up and this guy's just walking by and I'm like, holy crap, like, wow. Like, doesn't get any better that his shirt matches the color scheme. You have the arches and then the patterns on his shirt. And then I chased him down to see if it was my father-in-law because I'm like, it looks familiar. But it was just so perfect, and the fact that nobody was walking by, and, you know, preparation meeting luck is when you really get the best shots. Color versus black and white. This is pretty obvious why I shot this in color and left it in color. I say shot in color. Why I initially, I don't, you know, for those of you with black and white, I hope nobody in here shoots in black and white unless it's film. You know, if you want, we can talk about that later, but always shoot in color. But this one, I saw the guy coming and I initially didn't think that I was gonna get the shot. And, you know, normally when I stop people, they'll stop and I'll shake their hand and I try to, you know, go through my whole approach and everything. And this was one where kind of kept walking and didn't really give me the time of day, but eventually got the shot and it's kind of apparent why I left it in color. This one, another luck shot. I was gonna take a picture of the guy standing on the lime green backdrop. He was just standing there looking bewildered and I loved the lime green. And lo and behold, I look down and I see a Jeep coming. I literally was standing at this spot for about 30 seconds and I see a Jeep coming. I'm like, this is too perfect. I know nobody in here believes me right now, so if you want to see the raw file, I'll bring it. This is over in Harlem, and again, for obvious reasons, I love graffiti, and I just think her style and, you know, the pink on her bag, the, you know, the reddish stockings, like everything just fits perfectly in here, and to, you know, have this shot in anything other than color would be a disservice to it. Some black and white shots. This one I struggled in the process for color versus black and white. The girls are in very colorful dresses and they really popped off. But I looked at the old car and it's got the old New York license plates on there and it's just, it said like an old vintage shot. It's not the clearest of shots. It kind of is a little blurry, you know, the quality, you know, I cropped it down and the quality's not as great. So I said, you know what? I think it would look better as, you know, a vintage looking timeless black and white shot. This one, a lot of times it just comes down to color distraction. Bless you. The colors in the subway, it's very muddy light. The colors of the subway columns, very distracting here. And I know a lot of people will say, well, don't use black and white as like a fail safe. And I do believe that in a sense, but I don't believe that making a photo black and white because the colors are distracting is using it as a fail safe. I think that's more of a snob mentality. People just like to say, oh, well, you don't like the shot, and you try to make an uninteresting shot interesting by making it black and white. And I think this is an interesting shot, even with the color. But I just found that the color was distracting, and I really wanted the focus to be on, you know, what's going on. I mean, anybody who's ever been out 1, 2, 3 a.m. in the morning knows that it's probably a pretty accurate portrayal of what Penn Station looks like or any other Midtown subway station. This one right here, the colors were distracting, so it was the same reason as the last shot. You have some garbage over there, and I really wanted the power of the image to be the guy there with the pensive look on his face. You know, and I think when you suck color out of a photo, it brings a lot of the focus back to the characters in the photo and to what's going on in the photo. And this is one where I just felt the colors were distracting. This is, he's an actor, although I think everybody is in New York, or a model or a photographer. So his name's Al Burgos. And I talked to him, it was outside of Katz's. I was like, I'm outside of Katz's. This guy, you know, I liked his look. He had like that old, like tough guy look. Asked him for a picture and didn't even tell him to put his hands up. And he's like this. And I'm like, all right, this is like old, like, probably watches Raging Bull like every day. And so I'm like, you know, that I saw it as a black and white when I shot it. Capture the essence of the location. This is huge. This is, you know, almost everything in street photography is really, you know, I said, knowing the neighborhood. Now, how do you capture the neighborhood? How do you transport people to that neighborhood through your photos? So story time, you know, this is where you talk to people. You find out the stories. You know, I've dropped a couple stories on you today. It's like things that I remember that when I look through my photos, these are things that, you know, I've immersed myself. You know, I've made it more of an experience where it's not like, hey, I'm just going out to take pictures. I'm really capturing my experiences in these neighborhoods. Now, we talked earlier, I said, you know, when you're not comfortable and I go into telephoto mode, most of the time it's better to go unplugged. You shoot with your ears and your mouth. I can't tell you how many times I've been stopped by people who say nice camera or nice shoes. I got my trademark red sneakers on. But if I have my headphones in, I'm not listening to that. I don't hear that. I keep walking, and then they're just like, oh, he's rude. There's also been times where I've eavesdropped on conversations. I know it's probably rude, but you know what? It's led to some great interactions. I was out in a torrential downpour a couple weeks ago, and there's two ladies talking on the street. It was one lady and a male, and then a male lady talking. And the male lady was just so positive. She's like, whatever, you know, what can I do? It's my job. And I kind of just like butted in and made a joke. And next thing you know, all three of us are talking, and a lady who normally would have been shy and not opened up, you know, opened up to me taking a portrait of her. And, you know, I told her, I was like, you know, you have a beautiful soul. You have a beautiful spirit. I can just see it. And she started glowing. And it's like, you know what? I probably made that lady's day, and I know she made my day. You know, it's experiences like that where if I had my headphones on and I just kept on walking, I don't hear that conversation. I don't interact. I don't open up. So here, capture the essence. Does anybody want to take a guess what neighborhood this is? You got the east part, right? Lower East Side. When I talk about knowing the demographics of neighborhoods, it's like when I think of the Lower East Side, I think like, you know, old Puerto Rican neighborhood that, you know, you have people that have lived there since the 70s and 60s, and it's like block parties and, you know, the old Hispanic guys hanging out outside the bodega. And like when I looked at this shot and captured it, I was like, you know, this says Lower East Side to me. This is my Lower East Side. This is the Lower East Side as well. And, you know, it's kids selling candy. It's like, I grew up in New Jersey. And, you know, you went out for your baseball team and you sold candy. And it's like, I never sold candy from behind the bars of a fence. So this is something that's like, you know, these kids have to, you know, stand there and sell candy behind the bars of a fence because that's the neighborhood they live in, you know? And so I wanted to capture that. Now their parents are right off camera, and I asked, you know, talking to their parents through the fence, and I bought four candy bars to kind of, you know, I don't often throw people out money, but it's like, you know, in a situation like this where it's kids selling candy, and, you know, I wanted to support their cause because they're supporting my cause. You know, they're helping me capture the essence of that neighborhood. This is the 9/11 memorial, and this is something that's like, probably like anybody else in this room, it's very near and dear to us. It's like we were here, we lived through this. And I wanted to capture the memorial as, not just as I see it, but as I experienced it, as I felt it when 9/11 happened. And I waited this shot out for a group of tourists to finish taking selfies. And it was just kind of, it left such a bad taste in my mouth. It's like, you know, people taking selfies in front of something, you know, that's memorializing, you know, one of the worst acts in our history. And I wanted to capture, you know, the love, the sorrow, the pain, the hurt, everything. I just happened to luck out. This is pretty much, I try not to do a lot of processing to my photos because, you know, people have asked about this photo in particular. They're like, oh, it looks like it's lit. And it was just an overcast day, and I underexposed to really bring out the richness and the contrast and the colors, and I just found it to be a very strong shot that represents the memorial to me. This is another powerful shot to me. I was on the subway, and I saw a nanny with, you know, a couple of kids, and she had taken them out for, you know, a play date. They went out to, like, Build-A-Bear workshop, and they got off, and it wasn't even my stop on the subway, and I followed them off, and I'm just like, I saw the shot developing in my head, and I'm like, it's, you know, it's such, here you have like, you know, an older Hispanic nanny and the young privileged white girls, and I'm just like in my head, and you know, a lot of times when I shoot, it's like, I shoot in a very blunt manner. It's like, people get so like nervous about bringing up certain terms and pointing out certain things, and it's like, you know, I think to really see the streets and capture the streets, it's like you have to break down all barriers. You have to look beyond stereotypes. You have to see everything for what it is. And it's like, I never try to politicize anything, and I never try, you know, I try to capture things as they happen and put it out there. People see it the way they want. The way I see it was like, I, you know, saw it as, you know, just an interesting shot to me, to say the least, you know, how you have the nanny on the one side, and she was just like, you know, and the kids are all out having fun, and she's just kind of doing her job, and, you know, it was just an interesting occurrence to me. This right here is over in Brooklyn. I told you I love sneakers hanging from everything. Now, to me, it just totally is over in Williamsburg, and I saw the, you know, Williamsburg slash, like, you know, heading towards, like, Bed-Stuy, and, you know, gentrification is a big thing that's happening in Brooklyn and in New York in general. And it's like, here you have like the commingling of the, you know, the, you know, with the gentrification coming in, it's like you have Chuck Taylor's hanging next to Air Force Ones. And it's like, you have like two distinct groups right there. And it's like, you know, just them hanging together. And it was like, I kind of looked up at it and I was working on a Bedford Avenue project with a couple other photographers, and you know, the whole point of the project was to look at, you know, Bedford Ave and how, you know, when you go down Bedford Ave, you know, how it changes with the different demographics. And I looked up and I'm like, wow, that's like, that's it. That's what we're talking about. That's what the project is about. You know, you have these hipster sneakers hanging next to a pair of Air Force Ones. I live in a 99.9% Dominican neighborhood, so I see a lot of Dominoes. So this to me, this was actually shot in Brooklyn. I live in the Bronx, but any person who grew up in a Hispanic neighborhood, it's like when the weather gets nice, Dominoes. Like that's something that, you know, captures the essence. And, you know, I didn't even need to get the faces here. It was all about the hands and the Dominoes. And I love weathered hands. It's like, you know, you kind of can go to any neighborhood here and see the old guys playing Dominoes. This was in Harlem, right on Lenox Avenue. And I saw the guy's fur jacket through the window. And I'm like up in the window and I'm like, love your jacket. And he's like, give me the nod. And I was like, can I, you know, I'm trying to like, and he's like, so he goes around to the front. So I wanted a picture of the jacket, and it was in like a bar and they were closed during the day, but he was, you know, he was in there. He knows the owners and everything. So they unlocked the front door and the guy was so cool. And I'm like, I love your style. I always love when I see people that are a hell of a lot more stylish than I am. You know, because it's like, I couldn't pull off a fur, you know, fur coat. So I asked him for a portrait and I wanted something that, you know, captured him in the element, you know, an environmental portrait. And so he was nice enough to greet me. I did it, you know, had him over by the window, capture some nice directional window light, and that was that. This was in the South Bronx. And what I loved about this shot is, you know, South Bronx, it's like, it's, anybody who's been in the South Bronx is like, it's always a dirt bike, or 10 or 30, or if you go out on Sundays, there's about 400 of them. And you see like the younger kids that are looking up to the older guys and they're riding their bikes and doing wheelies. And so here you had, you know, the older kid on the dirt bike and the younger kid practicing his wheelies on a pedal bike. And I just thought it was kind of like a cool shot looking at like, you know, the kids and their mentors, their idols. This is pretty much the same scene. It was down in the South Bronx when all the dirt bikes are out and you have the young kids come out on their pedal bikes and line up and watch all the dirt bikes go by and wheelie. And I thought this, you know, was a cool shot just because you see them just lined up. It's almost like, you know, they're looking up like these are their sports figures. These are their athletes. These are the kids from their blocks that they're looking at and they're idolizing, you know, that they want to grow up and ride the dirt bikes just like them. I am also a bodega junkie. I love corner stores, bodegas. This is in the South Bronx. And initially what jumped out to me was the colors of this, but it is a very South Bronx shot to me. It's, you know, but initially it was the color on the bike matches the painting, the, you know, the siding on the store. People, I said it before, my work is very people-centric, and I think obviously, you look at the humans of New York, it's like it's a testament to how important humans are in New York. I mean, it's everything. When do I stop people? When do I not? It's probably one of the you know, other than how do you, you know, approach when people catch you taking candids, it's probably the most popular question I get is, well, you know, how do you take your portraits? When do you stop people? How do you ask people? And it's very simple. I decide, is it about the moment or is it about the person? Now, if you have someone who's very fashionably dressed leaning up against a light post and it's just dark out and there's a spot of light on them and they're holding a cigar and the smoke's curling off, it's obviously, as a photographer, that's a moment you want to capture. It's less about the person, it's more about the moment. So I'm going to do everything in my power to capture that candidly and leave that shot undisturbed. Now, remember the shot of the guy in the brightly colored, you know, colored gear and the red shorts and up against the graffiti? That guy, I would have shot him in front of a garbage can if I had to, because it was all about him. It was all about, the style was just so unique and colorful and vibrant that I had to capture him. Now, when I stop somebody on the street, it's a very simple, genuine approach. I go up to them, I introduce myself, you know, say, hey, how's it going? My name's Derek, I'm a street photographer. I shoot fashion style in the streets, or, you know, I shoot, you know, candid moments or whatever. Normally, if I'm stopping someone, it's because they have a look. So I'll tell them, you know, I shoot fashion and style in the streets. You have a wonderful look. Do you mind if I take a portrait of you? It's a very genuine approach. Now, anybody who's worked in sales knows that sales is 80% listening, 20% talking. On the streets, it's the opposite. It's 80% talking, 20% listening. Because I don't want to give somebody a chance to question me or say no. I just want their picture. So I'm going to tell you my name, who I am, what I'm doing, why I stopped you, and then I'm going to throw you a compliment. Now, if you turn me down after that, you're a horrible person. I was polite. I told you how beautiful you look, or how, you know, how nice your vest is. Most people don't turn me down. And when they do turn me down, I always hit them with the, how about this? You know, because people always say, oh, I don't like pictures. And I'll tell them, how about this? Give me one shot. I'll take one picture of you. And if you don't like it, you can erase it. Never had anybody ask me to erase a shot. The other one people use is that they're in a rush and they have a meeting. And I'm like, all right, here, I'll walk with you. And it's like, you know, and it's going to be quick, you know. Now, a lot of that comes down to having the confidence. You look at the approach and the confidence from whence it came. When I first started shooting people on the street, my ultimate nightmare was, great, I stopped somebody, they agreed to have me take their portrait, and what if my picture sucks? So a lot of it is born from confidence. You want to have the confidence so that when you show them that image, if they even care enough to see it, you want them to be like, wow, can you send that to me? Even though they're not going to email you, so it doesn't really matter. But it's all about confidence. It's about having that, you know, knowing that you can back it up. So just going to thumb through some shots quick here, just to look through, and these are some portraits I've shot. This was in the South Bronx, and it was in low-income housing, and I noticed the girl had beautiful eyes, and you're going to ask why I put it in black and white, and I just, for me, it's, again, it came down to distracting colors. I just wanted to make it about her and her mother. This was over in Brooklyn, and this was like a gotta-have-it shot. Like, she was beautiful. I loved her style. She probably can't walk a block in New York without someone stopping her to take a picture of her. And I didn't care where I shot it or what she was standing in front of. I just had to have the portrait. This is a homeless couple who's been homeless about 15 years. This is in the South Bronx. Now, it's a powerful image to me. I took this picture while standing on hundreds of crushed hypodermic needles. And they were under a bridge where they've lived. And you know, they kept on telling, you know, we're not junkies, don't mind the needles, look, we drink a little bit. And you know, the lady pulled out a little flask and she's like, yeah, we drink, but you know, we're not like that. They're very coherent. I had a great interaction with them. I was actually with a group of people when I shot this, and we talked to them for about a half an hour. They told us about, you know, the city's plan for homelessness and how they didn't agree with it, and just very smart, bright, you know, just very down-to-earth, personable people. And they had such a love for each other. And I think it was that love for each other that really keeps them going. And I wanted to capture that. And I think a bonus here is if you look, she kind of has like a twinkle in her eye. And it just said to me, it's like, you know, I like to, you know, I'm a writer and I was an English major and I like to really look in and analyze pictures. And I see that as like hope, you know, it's like you look at that twinkle in her eye and it's like there's a little bit of hope that she still has there. This is another cool one. We got into a little game of like, hey, let's show our tattoos. And now she showed me this tattoo. I stopped, I offered to take a family picture for her and her grandkids and her kids. And basically, to make a long story short, her husband passed away. and that's how she remembered him. She got her first tattoo in her 70s, and her and her husband always had a thing for dolphins. So she got two dolphins kind of, you know, interlocked like that. So I didn't even have to pay her to get her to show me the tattoo. She was very forthcoming. And this lady I chased down, I just loved the colors. I loved her style. I just thought she had a beautiful look. And she was completely perplexed when I stopped her and told her that. And she thought I was a creep, like trying to hit on her. These guys kind of speak for themselves. They were just very interesting characters. And I thought, you know, so we kind of joked around. I'm like, you know, I'll do like your album cover, you know, just interacting with them on the fly. So it's like, we didn't have like a nice Lamborghini or Bentley or Rolls Royce or anything. So I threw them on the hood of like an 87 Civic or whatever it was. My wife yells at me every time I show her this picture. I was out shooting in Bed-Stuy and bless you. Guy came up from behind, tapped me on the shoulder. It was like, you take pictures of dogs? And I'm like, I guess. Like, he's like, come back to my place. I got these, you know, Cane Corsos. They're huge dogs. He's like, why don't you come look and take pictures of them? So I followed this guy back to his house and I just met him and went into his backyard and I'm like, all right. You know, I just hope, you know, my family knows I love them and hopefully, you know, have a nice funeral and everything. So he was really cool. Got some pictures of his dogs and, you know, hung out back there for about 20 minutes taking pictures. And this was my favorite shot of the bunch just because it's, you know, it's kind of humorous to me. It's like that arm could have been my throat. So this is just a random person stopped on the street, and I just thought it was a very editorial, magazine-like image that, you know, it's always just been a favorite of mine just because of his look and, you know, the act of smoking the little cigarette. This is in the South Bronx, and I went down there, and it was, again, you know, I was stopped by people who, like, kind of like, you're out of place, what are you doing down here? And stopped and told them what I do, and they're still kind of looking at me like, no, you're a cop. And kept talking to him. And then it was funny because this guy's like, he's like, you have an Instagram? As if to like, if you're a cop, you won't have an Instagram. And I pulled up my Instagram and he thumbed through it and he's like, all right, you're cool. You could take a picture. And I'm like, all right, that was easy. So I captured the image. I love the tattoos on his arms. Why did you lift your camera and what does your photo say? Really, I mean, does your photo say something or is it just about the aesthetics? And I don't think every photo has to say something. You could have just liked how that building looked and took a picture of it. You know, street photography is free-flowing. It's whatever you want to make it, it's an art form. This, I mean, it's pretty apparent why I lifted my camera. I used to live in Washington Heights, and I saw this lady who was 5 foot nothing pushing, it had to have been 15 feet high. And I'm like, wow, that's impressive. And, you know, of course, I'm not going to pass that up right there. Again, I you know, always get asked, did you stage this shot? And no, I didn't stage the shot, but no, I didn't see the shot originally either. I was out shooting with someone, and he pointed it out. And I was totally embarrassed the fact that I didn't see it, because I'm like, I'm such an ego with like, oh, I saw it, and I got the shot. And my friend was like, I turn, I'm like, and I grab it. And it turns out that the guy's like, I live around the corner from here and I've always wanted a shot like this. And I'm like, does he just like go there and sit like totally confused. Like I didn't ask questions and I sent it to him and he loved the shot and he posted the shot on Instagram. And I'm like, I'm not even gonna ask questions, but it was like life imitating art. It was kind of cool. It was like, he has the exact same dog that's in the Bradley Theodore graffiti piece. It's a raccoon in the projects, which I thought was like, it was up in the tree. And I'm like, I was on my way home one night and I'm walking through the Polo Grounds and I see these two ladies come running, screaming. And I'm like, oh man, like what happened? I keep walking up and I see like two raccoons fighting on a branch. So I had to shoot this handheld. I shot this with a 5D Classic, which ISO only goes up to 3200. It was like pitch black. Like there's really the light here that you see is a godsend because I don't know how I, you know, kept my hand still. I was like posted on a fence trying to keep my hand still because, you know, I had no flash on me and I had to take a longer exposure to get any, you know, available light out of this, and thought it was kind of cool. He was staring me down. So there's levels to street photography. There's levels to any photography, you know, and what I want you to think about is, you know, when you leave here, I want you to be motivated. You know, how do you get to the next level? How do you take your photography, you know, to another place? And you've heard me talk about things that I love and things that I'm trying to push in my photography. And, you know, I don't want you to leave here and say, well, all right, I'm going to go set my camera like this. And no, I want you to leave here. I want you to have looked at these images and said, wow, it's like, you know, that motivates me to go out. And the next time I see someone pass, hey, maybe I want to stop them, or, you know, I want to have the bold nature to go out and shoot whatever I want to shoot. Fear is a four-letter word. The best shots do often require a little bit of guts and kind of just throwing all caution to the wind, just going for it. You know, a safe shot is usually not that great of a shot. All right. You were probably expecting something else, like guy with, like, you know, coming at me screaming and yelling, ready to smash my camera. The reason why, you know, this shot required guts is because I was in a Santa Claus suit. And this guy's in like a $10,000 bespoke suit, and you know, he has his own little boutique down in like NoHo. And I saw him through the window, and I totally, for a minute, forgot that I was dressed as Santa Claus. Now, it was for SantaCon. It's not like I just walk around dressed like Santa Claus, like on Tuesdays or whatever. I was down shooting SantaCon, and I'm like, all right, I'm gonna blend in. I'll get better pictures if I dress, you know, the part. So I was like the only sober Santa Claus running around the Lower East Side. I walk into this guy's like high-end boutique, and it's like, you walk in, it's not like Macy's where he's like suits on racks. You walk in and it's like, you know, guy, you know, mobsters and, you know, Italian race cars on the wall, and this guy's standing here, and he's like, you could see in his face that a guy dressed like Santa Claus is taking a picture of him. It's like, you know, I had to overcome the fear of like, all right, you know, screw it, I want the shot. And he's got such good style, and I love the backdrop and everything. And, you know, the interaction wasn't too warm and cozy. It was just kind of, you know, the face that he's making. That's kind of was how the interaction was. I shot this up in the Bronx. It's up in like the University Heights area. And he came up the stairs. I was actually just taking a shot of, I thought it was an interesting layout of the building there. And he came up the stairs and just like looked at me, and I'm like, and I loved how he was dressed. I loved just the composition, like just right there, like the blue sky and everything, and the green popped off of it with the orange hat. I'm like, I loved everything about it. And again, no fear, you know? I don't ever, because it'd be so easy for me to say, no, I'm not gonna take a picture of him. I don't, you know, he's on the phone, I'm not gonna bother him, or, you know, he looks like he would probably smash my camera. He came up and he looked like angry. And I put my camera up and he stopped, and this was the candid shot. He actually, after that, he stayed on the phone, but he was like this, and he's like pointing at me. And I like the candid shot better, but it's so funny. It's like, and I keep telling people, and it's like, we live with these, you know, these preset stereotypes and judgments in our head. And it's like, I'll go out into, you know, a neighborhood, I'll go out into the South Bronx, and it's like, I get so much love in neighborhoods like that just because I'm myself, just because I'm genuine, just because they know that I'm out, you know, I'm out there capturing their neighborhood in a way that represents it and not, you know, stereotypes it. This is over on the east side of Harlem on Lenox Ave as well. And, you know, I went down, there's a park right between 139th and 140th on Lenox Ave. And, you know, I was down there hanging out, and it's like, I had people asking me about my telephoto lens, and before you know it, they're like, you know, guy, like, oh, zoom in on that girl across the street over there. How close can you get in? And I'm like taking shots, and they're looking, you know, I'm letting them use my camera, and they're like so amazed. And it's like, it was like such a cool experience. And the next time I went down there, you know, it was like, they remembered me. There was the guy with the camera. And so you had the guy nodded off on the bench sleeping, and then these guys just hanging out there. And I just thought it was like a cool shot, but it's a shot that, you know, I wouldn't normally walk into that park. You know, it's like, I have no business being in that park. There's a lot of junkies and drug dealers and shady types in that park, and I normally would have no business in there. But the fact that I opened myself up and I got to know the people in there, and you know, this shot is personal to me because it's like guys that probably normally would be looking at me like, what are you doing down here with the camera, you know, or posing for the shot. Forecasting, not just for weather. A lot of what I do in the streets is forecasting. Where are people gonna walk? What direction are they headed? I have to see the shot developing. You know, you constantly have to pay attention to what backdrops do you have around. If I see somebody coming that has a very interesting look and I love, you know, their style and I wanna take a portrait of them, I instantly, the gears start going. Where am I gonna shoot them? You know, do I see a nice wall, or what kind of light am I working with? So I'm constantly forecasting, trying to read people's directions, and I chase people. If I see a shot I like, I will chase people for a half a block to get the shot, or just to get the shot in the right moment. So this is a shot. I saw him coming, and like there was a, you know, stopped at a red light, and I'm coming down a street, and I ran up to Broadway, and I ran like ahead. It's, you know, initially was like, all right, do I pan the shot? So I always like to get ahead of the shot so that I can prepare myself. I decided not to try to pan. It was in broad daylight. I'm like, you know what? I just want to make sure I get the shot. I don't want to, you know, go home and have just a blurry mess on my screen. But this is one that I forecasted. Finally, don't shoot alone. I think when you go out shooting, even with one person, you're more comfortable, you're more confident. It pushes you, it motivates you. Go out with people that shoot the same style as you, or that, you know, people that will, you know, you have to worry about grabbing. Like, I shoot with people who shoot the same exact style as me and will get the same shots as me. And it makes me a better photographer because I know I have to beat them to the shot. You know, we have this thing where it's like, you know, sniping or poaching. It's like, you don't want to poach somebody else's shot. So it's like, I have to see it first. And, you know, whoever has the quicker finger and whoever goes up to the person and stops them first. But do I do that when I'm out shooting by myself? No, it's so much easier for me to, you know, as outgoing as I am, it's easy to shell up and to not really interact with people and talk to people. But when I go out with people, it pushes you. You know, it makes you, it's almost like that show-off mentality. It's like, you know, kids will show off when they're in a group and by themselves. You know, when they're by themselves, they just clam up. It's the same thing with photography. You know, when I'm out with a group of people, I'm less hesitant to go up and talk to people. Finally, and we'll open it up to questions after this, everything I just said, I brought enough salt for everybody. Take it with probably a couple grains of salt. Nothing in photography is set in stone, as I've said multiple times. You know, find what works for you. Use this class, this lecture, this workshop, use it as motivation. Don't use it as a set of rules to go out. You know, this is how I shoot. This is what I see. This is how my creative process is. But, you know, I have people that motivate me in photography, but there's no one's work. You know, I try to look at the work of other photographers as little as possible, as crazy as that sounds, because subconsciously you're influenced by that. And I don't want to lose myself in somebody else's photography. Be motivated, yes, but I don't want my work subconsciously to turn into somebody else's work. Well, you guys are a wonderful audience. I hope I at least motivated you. Thank you so much for your time.
Whether you're a hobbyist or a professional, B&H has the answers to your questions. Experience a world of technology at our New York City Superstore. Connect with us online or give us a call. Our staff of experts is happy to help.